Sam Guarnaccia is a composer who was deeply influenced by Teilhard de Chardin. He composed an emergent universe oratorio that premiered in Cleveland in 2017 at the World Union of Jesuit Alumni, the World Conference. And he has numerous other projects underway. Sam.
Hello, everyone. Thank you, Mary Evelyn Tucker and John Grimm, for this wonderful event. Paula's and my work inspired by Teilhard began after conceiving of writing the oratorio that Jennifer mentioned in response, first to climate change, but after meeting Mary Evelyn and John in 2011, our focus shifted to the great universe story and the great work of Thomas Berry and his deep, deep connection with Teilhard de Chardin. And my personal inspiration has been much from it's a poetic inspiration from Teilhard, captured by these words of his. "Throughout my life," he said, "the world has caught fire in my sight until a flame all around me has become wholly luminous from within. My experience in contact with Earth at the heart of the universe on fire." And then he goes on in another place to say, "Driven by the forces of love, the fragments of the world seek each other so that the world may come into being." What a beautiful expression of evolution and emergence of the cosmos becoming cosmogenesis. So the structure of the oratorio and its content are closely related to the Journey of the Universe film and book. And I want to give you a sense and a feeling for the work and its performance next. So the very first performance with the early libretto and a small chamber group was in the great breeding barn in Shelburne Farms, Vermont, where you see Mary Evelyn and John, who were there in front of the barn. And next, please. Just a quick sense of what it took to set this magnificent space up. We had 800 chairs set up. We needed more. There were 1,200 people in the end. Next. And just a glimpse of the concert with the paintings that were part of the set design for this event. Next, please. Then in 2017, as Jennifer mentioned, we were invited by the World Union of Jesuit Alumni to produce the oratorio at their quadrennial world conference in Cleveland. And we brought Teilhard to the conference deliberately. And it was affected or added to the content of the conference. So here you're seeing the concert hall with the audience beginning to come in from behind the orchestra. Next, please. And here is the introductory remarks with the audience in place. You see Mary Evelyn and John and the far left with Paula introducing the concert next. And just a moment from the concert itself in one of the recitatives. Next, please. And then we're in the following year, the International Big History Association produced the oratorio as part of their world conference in Philadelphia. And I want to show you a video that has just a sampling of three of the concerts of what is called the lament, an expression of grief by children of the loss of species and of the viability of the earth. And then there will also be in this video clip a small portion of one of the choruses.
Trees, enforced across the world, struggle to adapt to environments that are rapidly changing.
Hinton's oak, African blackwood, monkey puzzle, four-petal pawpaw, Florida hue, sugar maple,
Caribbean coral reefs, Sri Lankan coral reefs, Surin Islands, Seychelles.
Hunt for these and for all life, going or gone forever, we share our lament.
Conversation, I am very happy to say, with Frank and Mary Frost, who are the possibility of creating music score for their two-hour documentary biography, the first ever of Teilhard de Chardin. And Frank will be presenting a little bit later, and we'll tell you all about that. A couple of other just connections that are developing with the Land Institute in Salina, Kansas, and with the Center for Ecozoic Studies. And I'm working on a final, on another major work for chorus and orchestra called Threshold. So next, please. In 2022, in March, there is a concert planned with a great choral organization in the capital area of New York City, New York. The Albany Pro Musica Orchestra and Chorus is going to produce the concert in this amazing venue here. And this is the Experimental Media and Performing Arts Center at Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute. The concert hall is the New York Times said of the 21st century. Remarkable thing. Next. It is where they say the arts, science and technology meet and breathe the same air. It's like a musical instrument itself. Next. And we're working with the faculty and students at the Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute to develop in conjunction with an artist from the University of Vermont, Andy Davis, to create a digital set design. And this is part of the infrastructure for digital acoustic design at MPAC. And next, and the final slide is of the magnificent concert hall. The space itself is a musical instrument of sound and light. And imagine 80 voices, full orchestra, and an immersive light, moving light environment that embraces this entire experience. So to end with Teilhard's beautiful words, love, he said, is the only force which can make things one without destroying them, the threshold of another universe. Thank you.
Oh, thank you so much, Sam. Wow, this is a lot to look forward to. Two religious leaders who are going to speak today. And the first person is Nancy Wright. The Reverend Dr. Nancy Wright is pastor of Ascension Lutheran Church in South Burlington, Vermont. She co-authored Ecological Healing, A Christian Vision, Christianity and Environmental Justice, and a chapter in Living Water, in Living Cosmology, Christian Responses to Journey of the Universe. With her congregation, she developed a watershed stewardship manual for other congregations.
Thank you. It's so great to be part of this. My great work as an ordained clergywoman for 47 years is to connect heaven and earth, matter and spirit, Christianity and science. When in high school, a daughter of a geologist, I preached a sermon at our Colorado Congregational Church. I stated that it is as though we are all walking around on paper, with no sense of being surrounded by a glorious, beautiful creation. Perhaps I intuited and was disturbed by a problem within the church and culture to which, as Thomas King writes, Teilhard de Chardin passionately responded, quote, "Christianity seems to be an alien thing in itself, added to the universe from without," unquote. At Barnard College, majoring in world religions, and at Union Theological Seminary in New York City, training for the ordained ministry, reading the assigned Teilhard's The Phenomenon of Man and the Divine Milieu, I knew that Teilhard stated a central truth. The Christian story unfolds within the universe story. Teilhard became a very important spiritual and theological teacher in my religious vocation. He expanded the Christian understandings and symbols with scientific knowledge and wrote compellingly about his vision. All of my subsequent experience, including the Teilhard Association Saturday lectures in Riverdale and coming to love Thomas Berry, all affirmed the interweaving of Christianity and the cosmic story. These experiences also illuminated the struggle engaged in by many people to retrieve, reevaluate, and reconstruct the Christian religious tradition as called for by Mary Evelyn Tucker and John Grimm in their book, Ecology and Religion. This ongoing struggle renders Teilhard's writings and experiences even more illuminative, more necessary for all of us caught up in the urgent drama of Christian response to the ecological crisis. Teilhard was a scientist, paleontologist, philosopher, and Christian theologian, as well as a mystic. Of his theology, Ian Barber, in his magisterial book, Religion in an Age of Science, notes that Teilhard's writings may be seen best as a theology of nature, and that, quote, "his unifying vision is indebted to both evolutionary biology and the Christian tradition," unquote. Teilhard situates himself between science and Christianity. The first sentence of the foreword in the Phenomenon is, quote, "this work may be summed up as an attempt to see and to make others see what happens to man and what conclusions are forced upon us when he is placed fairly and squarely within the framework of phenomenon and appearance," unquote. The last sentence of the book's appendix is, quote, "in one manner or the other, it still remains true that even in the view of the mere biologist, the human epic resembles nothing so much as a way of the cross," unquote. Thomas Berry summarized so well my experience of the grafting of Teilhard's views into my heart, mind, and soul. In his essay, Teilhard in the Ecological Age, Berry appreciatively writes that Teilhard, quote, "shifted the central focus of Western religious tradition from redemption to creation. This new orientation might be considered the single most powerful aspect of Teilhard's theological thinking. Possibly it can be considered among the most significant theological changes since the 16th century. Due to Teilhard," Berry continues, "the Christian story identifies with the cosmic story told by modern science, although it sees in this story a sacred significance far beyond what is seen by the secular scientist. This can be the beginning of a new era in both the religious and the secular history of our times," unquote. Berry notes five concerns of Teilhard that need extension, among which is the activation of human energies at a new level of intensity. Berry believed that Teilhard did not find sufficient consolation and inspiration in the spontaneities of the natural world, recounted, for example, by Humboldt, Thoreau, Muir, and so many other writers and explorers. I wonder that perhaps due to Teilhard's magnificent achievements in the thought life of the 20th century, such tremendous efforts didn't often allow him to have such nuanced natural contemplation moments. Perhaps Teilhard didn't have time to wander all day to meet the grasshopper whom we have come to love. As she lifts her pale forearms and thoroughly washes her face, in Mary Oliver's poem, The Summer Day. Perhaps Teilhard wasn't driven by despair in just the same way as was Wendell Berry when he goes to lie down where the wood drake rests in the peace of wild things. Or perhaps in bed, due to a mysterious illness, he was never given a terrarium with a violet and a snail, recounted in Elizabeth Tova Bailey's book, The Sound of a Wild Snail Eating. But all who notice and love the natural world form a web of people strengthened by insight into the wondrousness of creation. Teilhard gifted me with energy and theological expression to link ecology and religion. Most recently, in the creation by the church I serve of a Christian and interfaith congregational watershed discipleship manual. The goal is to guide congregations to learn about, pray with, and become intimate with their own watersheds. Our church took 7 months to worship by Lake Champlain in Vermont, to write poems about the lake and Adirondack Mountains surrounding it, to immerse Sunday school students in activities about water, to learn about the stress on the lake, to advocate for lake protection in the capital, Montpelier, and to conclude the seven-month focus with an art show that exhibited photographs, watercolors, sculptures, a book of hours, and quilts, all focused on the beautiful Lake Champlain region enveloped by the green and Adirondack Mountains. Ecstatic encounters Teilhard knew. That morning in China, which led to the Mass on the World, which has gifted all of us who celebrate and partake of Holy Communion with his companionship, insight, and joy, as we worship embedded in all Earth's varied ecosystems and watersheds, and thank and praise with the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, and join their unending hymn, Holy, holy, holy. Thank you.
Brother Kevin Cawley is executive director of the Thomas Berry Forum for Ecological Dialogue at Iona College. Kevin serves at the United Nations headquarters in New York as the main representative of the Edmund Rice International. And he produces a monthly newsletter for his organization on environmental concerns.
Thank you, Jennifer. And thank you especially to Mary Evelyn and John Grimm. The Thomas Berry Forum at Iona College actually grew out of a conversation that took place at the funeral of Thomas Berry in 2009. A group of his students on the way home from the funeral decided this can't end here, and they began to formulate plans for a follow-up in some structured way. So Danny Martin, Brian Brown, and Kathleen Degnan in particular asked me to help organize things. So the Berry Forum was, in a sense, born out of the passing of Thomas Berry, founded a place at Iona College in New Rochelle. We also had some other partners. We want to remember Rabbi Larry Truster, who was very essential to our early days. You can see Thomas's picture there on the screen from the website. And then we have a little section here where we talk about our mission. And I'll go through this carefully because I think it's important to understand. Thomas, coming out of his understanding of Teilhard and then moving in his own way, put us on this path. The Berry Forum is a creative resource for the entire Iona College community and for the many other dialogue partners, regional, national, and global, whom we hope to engage in Berry's great work to awaken the ecological phase of human development. The mission of the Thomas Berry Forum for Ecological Dialogue at Iona is to educate for awareness of the integral Earth community, to facilitate deeper understanding of human responsibility for care of Earth, to promote scholarly dialogue and engagement around significant ecological concerns, to celebrate our communion in the family of God's creation, and to inspire hope and empower action for a sustainable and environmentally just world, with special concern for the most vulnerable members of the Earth community. And we act this way in all of our efforts. And here we'll take a look at some of the events. We've had about 40 events in the last few years, but we'll just start with how we operate. We're doing a lot of work with Laudato Si on care for our common home. And you can see here, we have presented in a number of parishes. It turns out we presented most recently in Croton-on-Hudson, New York, with the work on crisis in the natural world, faith responds, with a special emphasis on Laudato Si and the Holy Father, Pope Francis. Laudato is now celebrating its fifth anniversary, and we're hoping to continue that celebration throughout the year. It's also part of our work that the Berry Forum, along with the Degnan Earth and Spirit Institute, hosts a monthly Earth Mass at Iona College in the College Chapel. You can see it's been decorated there. And we invite people from the different parts of our little universe at Iona to come and be with us. And we have presentations, we have music. Brian Brown, who is one of the co-founders of the Berry Forum, is often the person who gives the reflection at the Mass. We've also been able to have other visitors to Iona's campus. One of the things that we are most proud of is recently, last November, we hosted the launch of the Thomas Berry biography. And Mary Ellen and John were wonderful about coming to Iona, bringing copies of the book, talking about Thomas. We had a slideshow, we had a presentation, we had young people. Very important part of this work is to engage the young. So they were part of our story that day. You can see Mary Evelyn and John at the lectern there speaking about the work and the biography. We had a little portrait of all the young people who were there for the event. We also had a lovely group portrait at the end because we were able to take our plaques, which were presented as the Berry Foundation Award from the Thomas Berry Foundation to the Berry Forum at Iona College. We were very pleased and, as we say, humbled by that work. We also know that one of the things that the Berry Forum has to do is connect again with what's happening in the world. We have been with young people marching for climate easily enough in New York when there was a time for all of that to happen. And you can see in these photographs, a lot of young people were marching with that idea in mind, especially when Greta Thunberg made her appearance in New York. So we participated in that and we brought a number of Iona students down to the event. During the last summer, not long ago, we had a conference in Omaha, Nebraska, the Creighton University, the Jesuit school out there, celebrating Laudato Si. And we had a number of contacts there and spent the couple of days digging into Laudato and beginning the work of preparing for the fifth anniversary. We know that we must continue this work. So we have always tried to include the students. You can see last year's ATA conference at Union Theological. We had a number of students there. There's a picture of the students with Mary Evelyn at the end of that event. That's a very helpful part of the work. And we know that we've convinced a number of students to continue their engagement with the Berry Forum and with the questions that Thomas has raised. In particular, we're happy to report Sister Kathleen Degnan was able to meet with Cardinal Peter Turkson in Rome. He is the point person for the efforts of Laudato Si. And there is Sister Kathleen with two of her students, Jamal and Kira, who were part of the journey to see the work that's going on in the Vatican. Cardinal Turkson was very happy to see young people engaged in this effort. We'll shift a little bit This is another part of my work, the website I take care of. You can see I have a Carbon Rangers newsletter archive. It goes back about 10 years. But the one we're looking at today has to do with the pandemic recovery, because one of the things that's happened with our care of Earth and our common home is we know that we're going to have a tremendously difficult moment when we come out of the pandemic and we have to, again, return to care of Earth questions. It's been helpful to be aware that here is a sample of what we were looking at. The last 4 years, this is nitrous oxide in our atmosphere in this part of the world, March of last year, and then NASA shows us what happened this year in March to the nitrous oxide in this part of North America. We can, pardon the expression, breathe again, but we know that's going to be hard to maintain. So here it is, last March and this March. Thomas was very, very concerned about how we live and respond to care of Earth, and the Pope Francis encyclical is bringing that back to bear. And I hope that we can continue to move in a good direction here. And I thank you very much for your attention.
Oh, thank you so much, Kevin. Sant Aranda lives in Mexico City and is working to shape our future in the spirit of Teilhard by designing and building sustainable human developments and energy projects by advising new businesses to incorporate elements of sustainability. And he has developed eco-spirituality programs that focus on caring for the environment and environmental education.
Well, thank you very much, Mary Evelyn and John, for inviting me over. And thank you for your over 40 years of presidency at the ATA. It's been a very welcoming community to all of us who aspire to bring Teilhard into our daily conversations and to influence us in our daily work. Next. I want to talk to you about a play that in 2016, through the generosity of Father Enrique González Torres, a Jesuit, was made possible. And it was a play that was written by José Ramón Enríquez, one of the great screenwriters of Mexico. Luis de Tavira, which is an institution in the theater world here in Mexico, and José María de Tavira, recognized actor here in Mexico. Next. The pamphlet that we gave to each of the attendants to the play was this brief introduction to Teilhard, trying to combine the views of faith and science, as if it was what some people think it's a contradictory view, whereas Teilhard, in Teilhard's mind, was one whole view, one whole system. And what we tried to do was to bring that kind of knowledge and way of thinking throughout the life of Teilhard ever since he was a boy, and incorporate that or intertwine that with common day Mexican issues regarding social justice and energy. As a matter of fact, the book also, the play also draws from some of the interviews that a reporter did to a survivor of Chernobyl, and that's the opening stage of it. Next. The play has very interesting actors, as you can see there. One of them was Marina de Tavira, who was recently nominated for an Oscar award as a supporting actress. And the play follows Teilhard and his relationship with matter. And we represent that with a rock, and how the rock that is a precious treasure for Teilhard accompanies him throughout his life and through his adventures. Next. In the next slide, you will see a short preview of what the yardbook looks like, or how we did it. That was just a small example of what the play is. But in the next slide, you will see some of the photographs we have of the scenography that we had. Next. You could see the life of Teilhard follows the life of the rock that I was telling you about. And actually in the last photograph there at the very bottom, it's where when Teilhard leaves all his legacy and work to Madame Mortier. And one of the things he leaves, obviously, is this rock. But the play goes all the way to Shuanghan, China, where the discovery of the Peking woman happens. It also goes to the front of First World War in Africa, where Teilhard becomes a war hero. And it has a beautiful scene with a piece of the mass on the world. And it is a very powerful moment where you can see Teilhard praying over the world. Next. The next slide shows the Teilhard's influence in today's world. In the Mexican social justice issues that we have regarding drug cartels, narc, and and energy issues, you could see that also there is concern about the people, the indigenous communities that we have. And so with that, the play has also, besides Chinese and Latin, has all indigenous language built up within the screenplay. Next, you can see how the scenography goes from jungle to China and the travels that the yard did in Asia. Next. There you can see how it is the Museum of Natural History in Paris or the Shoukondian in China cave, where a lot of anthropological important discoveries were made. Next. Our outreach that we had involved two seasons in the theaters of the arts in the National Center of Arts, where actually was the first time that the theater was full to its maximum capacity, reaching over 11,000 people. And we toured three Mexican cities, León, Guadalajara, and Torreón. Next. We did a lot of press and social media that involved interviews, articles, and shows in radio stations, TV stations, where we try to bring Teilhard into the conversation and make it again a topic of discussion for the younger generations or new generations. Next. We had science and spirituality roundtables where we participated with Jesuit paleontologists, anthropologists in different universities, in science museums, where there was a meteorite event. We had some star watching, some old Jesuit colleges that were turning to museums. They were all the background of these conversations that were very engaging to a lot of different communities. So that's the play, and thank you. Thank you for your attention.
Frank and Mary are experienced, award-winning filmmakers who have been members of the American Teilhard Association for many years. So it's not surprising that Teilhard would inspire them to take on a major documentary for public television on the life and legacy of Teilhard.
Thank you, Jennifer. It's a pleasure and an honor to be reunited with all of you today via Zoom. And we know of friends who are present from Switzerland, Holland, and Australia, and many other places. So we know we are gathered from around the globe, experiencing the noosphere. As many of you know, Mary and I have been working on a documentary about the life of Teilhard for a number of years. Destined for public television, it requires that we raise all the funding ourselves. So that has limited the amount of work we have been able to accomplish at any given time. But we have made continual and great progress. We have completed the major task of all the international filming in France, England, and multiple locations in China, and also a number of insightful interviews in English, French, and Mandarin. Many of you in this meeting have become stakeholders in this project by making financial contributions to the film, and for that we're grateful. Thank you. Those of you who are just now learning about the project can go to our website, teilhardproject.com, and while you are there, you can sign up for our newsletter to stay abreast of the project. Now, most of you know at least some of the details of Teilhard's life and of his struggles. It makes a great television story, a clerical Indiana Jones, a 20th century Galileo, a man who was not afraid to love. This will be the first film about Teilhard on American television, and there's only been one previous TV show in English 55 years ago on the BBC. So we'll be opening up a whole new audience to his story and ideas. Our approach to telling Teilhard's story relies heavily on his own words from his letters and essays, and the words of those who wrote to him. We'll take our audience in his footsteps from his formative years in childhood years in Auvergne, his Jesuit studies and ordination in Hastings, England, the Crucible of Verdun, the most dramatic of 67 places he served in the Great War, his life and studies in Paris as a shooting star in the world of geology, suppression by his Jesuit superiors, and his 25-year exile in China, where, ironically, the discovery of Peking Man catapulted him into international fame, and where he met Lucille Swan, and finally, his second exile in New York City. All of these are integrated with expert commentary from top Teilhard scholars. It's through understanding Teilhard the man that we can recognize elements of his vision that almost erupt from his intense motivations and struggles. Ideas that viewers can pursue more deeply by way of a website and links to many other resources. We're looking to finish next year, but as always, that's dependent on funding and the unknown effects of the pandemic. Despite these obstacles, we'll continue moving ahead. Right now, we're in the post-production phase, editing all the footage we have acquired and working on transcriptions and translations. We'd hoped to be filming in New York City and at Teilhard's grave this month, but COVID forced a postponement. Some of the other major tasks coming up will include major research and acquisition of archival footage of World War I, of 1920s Paris, 1930s China, and 1950s New York City. It will include casting and recording voice talent, final online editing, sound design, and music scoring. And for this last one, music, we're happy to be working with Sam Guarnaccia, who you had heard from earlier, to provide the musical score. We'd like to give you a very small taste now of the direction we're going by showing a draft 2-minute clip. Being a work in progress, the voices in this clip are stand-ins. The music is stand-in. The editing needs to be polished and sound effects added, but it illustrates our approach. Sparse narration, reliance on Teilhard's words, giving the story room to breathe with images from the places he lived and worked, in this case, from his Auvergne roots. Here's the clip. Thank you.
Auvergne molded me. Auvergne served me both as museum of natural history and as a wildlife preserve. Sarsena in Auvergne gave me my first taste of the joys of discovery.
Daily walks with his father, and later alone, taught him to see, to really see, the contours and shape of the land, its stones, flowers, insects.
To Auvergne, I owe my delight in nature.
His cathedral of trees merged with the deep Catholic piety absorbed at his mother's knee.
I hope that gives you a sense of where we're going, and thanks for this opportunity to present.
Thank you so much, Frank and Mary. Best of luck on this really great project.